Anyway, welcome everyone to Circular Coffee or Tea and Conversation. It's set up by me and Sophie, and we run the Circular Economy Club in Reading, which really looks to kind of connect, share, and amplify local and wider circular initiatives for inspiration. We started this during lockdown one, two, at some point, when we actually had the energy to kind of come and hopefully connect and get this going with you. And actually we've really enjoyed it and people have found it really valuable as well. And we get some really interesting guests. So Sophie will be interviewing or chatting really with Campbell Murray from Souqbox, probably for about 15 minutes. And then we'll open up for questions that you might have from those who've joined us. If you'd like to use the chat facilities to kind of share your LinkedIn, share your thoughts, or note down questions as they come up, then we'll be able to kind of flag them at the end of the session. So without further ado, I'll hand over to Sophie.
Hi everyone, lovely to see you again. Right, so let's jump in straight onto that. So we've got Campbell joining us today, and it's actually really exciting to have you here because Campbell was part of our lunch event that we had in Reading many moons ago now. And we said we've got to find a way to bring him to our conversation, and I think the topic today is absolutely perfect for that. So Campbell, thanks for joining us.
Pleasure.
Cool. So we always ask our guests to bring a circular conversation starter. So I was wondering, what did you bring us today? Do you have something?
Yeah, good question. I know I haven't actually got anything. But what I was thinking about was the phone. Because I think my journey into this space is kind of a parallel to this bit of technology here. I was trying to find a really old Nokia phone. But I think my kids have dismantled them now, so I have none left. But for anyone over the age of 35, you possibly remember not having a mobile phone. Anyone under the age of 35 now, the idea of not having a mobile phone is like not breathing. It just doesn't make any sense. And I think what that kind of industry, probably more than any other industry did, was lightning speed growth, lightning speed adoption of hardware and lightning speed adoption of services. But it really got me thinking, there's a company called Shields based in Essex. And I met the founder of that a bunch of years ago, and he was at BT back in the day. And we were ripping out and modernizing digitizing the exchanges to get rid of it. You remember the old-fashioned plug-in? You used to see in old-fashioned movies, and you call the operator and they connect the cables. Well, they were ripping out all the final part of the exchanges, and he discovered there was just full of precious metals. And he went to BT, an internal project, and said, "Hey, look, we've got probably millions of pounds worth of precious metals tied up in these old machines. We should be extracting that and using it to make money for the company." And BT were like, "Look, mate, this is too hard. Just forget it. Just get rid of it. Pay someone and take them away." And he was like, "Well, why don't I do that then? So if I leave BT and set up a company and you pay me to take them away, that'll work." And he did that, and he's now worth hundreds of millions of pounds. Because in those exchanges were gold and copper and various other metals. And so Shields International was set up to initially strip out the BT exchanges, now moved into mobile phones. And that harvesting of secondary equipment is now a really established industry. But 25 years ago, 30 years ago, it was not. It was brand new. And I always found that really interesting. Why was it that the industry leaked? I mean, if you look at from a shareholder perspective, BT turned around in their annual account and said, "We had £200 million in a bank account. We just gave it away. I hope that's all right, guys." Now, that wouldn't go down very well. But that's effectively what happened. They had 200 million quids worth of gold and other materials that they'd lost sight of and that wasn't tracked in their balance sheet and had been written off because it was a bit of a kit. But it had value outside of that, a very clear, transparent value outside of its purpose. So that got me really thinking. The mobile phone industry has probably been and I spent 10 years with Vodafone. So I've seen it firsthand, the evolution of old phones and new phones, and the sheer cycle of change. I don't think there's any other industry I can think of where the hardware changes so fast as it does in mobile phones. We are inextricably linked to the latest phones. It's a thing that we do. We don't, last year's phone only had 500 megapixel camera. I want one with a, 750 megapixel camera now, please. And it just keeps going. And that creates a huge circular economy in the mobile phone industry. And it's probably the best example, I think, of an industry that's embraced circularity in its core. So phone back and these kind of services that have been set up over the years, are all about, you know, enabling the kind of the equipment to come back in and get repurposed. And if it's not repurposable, it gets broken down into its core precious metals and recycled. So that industry is weird. In fact, one of our first customers, a company called N2S in Souqbox, my journey started off as a tape stock. We created a food business model. We were trying to solve the circular economy model in the food industry at the macro level. My business partner is a food guy, and he's like, look, there's billions in food every year waste managed at factories. No one's talking about that. People talk about the domestic level, and they look at, you know, restaurants throwing away food or households throwing away food, but actually more than half the food that's wasted is in the food chain from farm to the factory. And we thought that was an interesting problem to go and tackle. So we built Tape Stock to go and do that, and that was our first business together. We're actually just in the process of closing down. We shut down 2 weeks ago, actually, mainly because Souqbox is my focus. I can't do both, and we couldn't raise for Tape Stock. We had problems raising, structural reasons. But we managed to get 1,600 customers, 1,700 customers on it, or businesses. So there was an appetite there on the sell side, and we took a long time to get going. We got the top 20 food companies in Europe, including Bakkavor, Two Sisters, all these guys on board. So we kind of got quite a bit of success with it, but we just couldn't get it to this next level. And it opened up structural problems for me in B2B. And you know, you think about B2B in the sense of, at the end of the day, it's people. So I think of it as a really interesting dynamic, because in the B2B world, 80% of the B2B product world globally is still offline. It's about $7 trillion in trade. It's offline. And if you compare it to the consumer economy, the B2C economy, it doesn't make sense. It's, you know, why is it so different? It is like having a Tesla for the weekends, and then you go to work on Monday and they hand you the keys to a 1960s Morris Marina as your company car. You'd be slightly baffled why we're not using Teslas at work. Why are we using these old oil-burning cars from the 1960s? And it is like that in tech sometimes. B2B in particular, I think, is so far behind. It's quite astonishing. And that then opened up an even bigger challenge for the US as well. If you're going to tackle B2B circular economy models around the world, you need to get the B2B world to go online and start trading online and get used to that experience that we all take for granted as consumers. And these people do that, right? These decision makers, the middle management layer in any B2B business is probably 35 to 45. So they've grown up digital. So surely in their personal lives, they're using services. So whenever I meet digital customers, my conversation always starts with, which of these services do you use in your private life? Do you use Amazon? Yep. eBay? Oh, yeah, we buy everything on that. What were your groceries? My wife buys everything in Tesco.com. Everything. Okay, your business is offline. And they go, yeah, but that's because we go and see our customers. We don't need to sell it online to them. And then along comes COVID-19. And we've got customers that a year and a half ago were saying to us, yeah, but no one really wants to buy online. People just get in planes and cars and go see the customers. And that's how things are done. It's how we always do it. So can't see online working for us. And then COVID started. And over the last year, all those guys that were resisting have now sort of come around going, maybe I need to start an online sales process. So in some respects, COVID-19 might turn out to be one of the biggest catalysts for changing behaviors in the underlying enablers, which is digitization. Because I think if you get digitization right, it seems to me quite inevitable that circular economy models in B2B can move forward. The biggest problem we have is getting people to accept this idea of trading online, you know. And we had a lot of reticence in that, a lot of kind of trust issues and people saying, well, I'm a business, I don't buy online. I get my supplier to come to me. And that's the biggest change we think we're seeing over the last 12 to 18 months, which we then hope will percolate into a more digitized world for B2B. And that's what Souqbox is. We're trying to power that revolution of B2B. Get online, start trading online, make money online, move your business online. And then other things will come from that.
Yeah, I absolutely love your passion. You know, it's like whenever we talk, you can really hear it and see. And I think that passion to really solve those really big challenges with the tech that there is. I've got a couple of follow-on questions, if that's okay, because today is really focused on the B2B. And that's a segment that we hadn't really looked into that. But, you know, almost like in a nutshell, what do you think is the main difference in between the B2B and the B2C when it comes to the circular economy?
Well, apart from what I've just described about the lack of digitization and familiarity with digital models, I think without digital, circular is very hard. The circular economy has been utterly linked by coincidence. So that the global movement of circularity, the global movement of planetary resource management and being better stewards of the planet has run at the same time as the internet. Now, you can say that's a coincidence. I don't think it is. I think the enablement of technology has sparked a conversation about, look what you could do. This could happen. Look at the consumer space. Look at eBay. Look, people look at Gumtree and Craigslist and all these services around the world that are enabling people to circulate items within the circular economy of consumer. You know, that's been the catalyst that's kind of brought, I think, this to the reality of you can do this. It's just possible now. I think it'd be pre-internet, it'd be quite hard to find people. I think the nature of circular, so let me go back a level. So I think that this is what we really found with TasteLock. So business to business tends to be described like this in terms of supply chain. I buy from a narrow set of suppliers. I buy under a very strict buying criteria. I will go through RFPs and processes. I'll visit the factories. I will invest in my supply chain to make sure I get what I want, when I want, the right quality. So you're telling me I should buy from somebody I don't know on the internet and use that in my product. That is unthinkable for a lot of businesses and a lot of people. And so in order to start cracking that problem, you've got to bring in provenance. You've got to bring in trust. You've got to bring in issues that need to be solved. And I think that technology can do that in a way that would be very difficult before. It's a bit like a dating site. If you imagine a dating site, if you business to business for the circular economy is a wee bit like a dating site. You've got to kind of match supply and demand in a way that's trusted and builds confidence with both parties. And that takes time. And so I think the biggest trend is getting that world to go online and be digital first. And I think if that happens, the behaviors that can enable online trading will improve circularity. But I think the second biggest issue is the one I just talked about, the supply chain, which is this idea of, since I, you know, if I'm a buyer in any business and I'm in my mid-40s and I've been doing this for 25 years, all I've ever done is that kind of RFP-driven, standards-driven supply chain type conversation. And I have to completely shift my mindset to an idea that maybe I could just buy something as a one-off. Someone's going to throw it away and I could reuse it, good for the environment, I'll get it cheaper. Because let's face it, it always comes down to money. No one's ever going to embrace circular economy if they're paying the same amount for an untrusted source as they get it from a trusted source. It's not going to do it. So we've got to be realistic about this. But if someone's going to throw it away and somebody else might want it, that works. And one of the big things that we saw on TakeStock, which is possibly the biggest lesson I learned in TakeStock, was that the big guys are the sellers and the wee guys are the buyers. You'll never, ever, ever persuade the big guys to buy. I don't think it's possible because of what I've just described. And I think it comes down to corporate governance and protecting people's jobs and legal issues and stuff. I mean, the lawyers would have a heart attack if you went to them. If you were at Unilever and you went to your legal team and said, we're thinking of buying a load of stuff from some factory we met on the internet, we haven't been to see and don't know them, and is that okay if we buy like that? I think you'd find the lawyers would be like, over my dead body, mate. There's too much risk involved, you know. Whereas, you know, if it's a given, you know, supplier, we've got that kind of legal protection in place. If anything goes wrong, we can sue them. We know they've got enough liability insurance. All that stuff's in place to protect us downstream. If you're asking me to go to an untrusted source, you are breaking, you're literally ripping up every trading rule in the book to do it. And therefore, I think the wee guys are always going to be the buyers. The owner businesses, entrepreneur businesses that have got an owner running them, they're the guys that can go, well, you know, that's half the price I normally pay for that product. Let's just send me a sample. If it looks good, we'll take a risk. Obviously, some industries are more sensitive than others. You know, if it's food, it's quite difficult because there's a lot of provenance. But I think in other industries, you know, it's much easier to see what things are. You know, if it's the secondhand telecoms and electronics industry, you know, if you've got 5,000 Nokia phones, let's have a look at a sample of some of them. And if they come in and they're good enough, maybe we'll use them. So I think that's kind of easier in some models than others.
Yeah. Now, it's really interesting. I love what you say, Fred. There's a lot of different aspects, of course, but there's this creativity in looking at, you know, what we're doing in the different ways, but also the supply chain. And I think the traceability and looking at the tech that we can use there is really important. When we look at the circular economy as well, there's a lot that is around system thinking and collaboration, because as you say, like the supply chain is not just you, it's a lot of people basically that you have to bring on board. What do you see on that front? Do you see collaboration? Do you see people getting together? What's your view on that?
Yeah, I think there's a lot of desire to do it. I think turning it into action is the hard thing. I mean, go back to TakeStock, right? So we've got examples where, I won't name them, but there's some very, very large companies who you will know, where we've been at sea level talking to the chief strategy officers and chief marketing officers and chief executives. And they've come away. I mean, there's one of the biggest food businesses in Europe. We were in with the CEO and the team. We got a round of applause at the end. They were like, this is the best thing we've seen in years in the food industry. You're going to shake it up. It's awesome. We're going to tell all of our factories to do this, all of them. And not one did. So the CEO and the board wrote to the factory heads through the operations director, do this, and none of them did. And we were like, they went back to the board and said, what's going on? I thought you guys had power here. You told them to do it and they're not doing it. And they're like, oh, God. And then it turned out that at the factory level, you know, you kind of got this kind of like, yeah, that sounds great, but I've got a business to run here. And that just sounds like a distraction. So one guy, these guys do a lot of things under contract management. And they've got a massive factory, I won't name where it is, in the middle of England, because you might work at this company, and they're huge, they make for a big retailer, and they're making sandwiches and fresh products for a big retailer. And I went to see the operations director there, and he said to me, look, it's really simple. If I don't have 2,500 migrant workers in here tomorrow morning, and at the next shift, 8 hours later, and the 8 hours after that, if I don't get that, I lose my job. That's all I care about. That's all I care about. And I spent all my life making sure that there's 2,500 people coming in for their shift at 8 o'clock in the morning, 4 o'clock in the afternoon, 2 o'clock the following morning. That's all I've got headspace for. And I suddenly realized that in some industries are worse than others at this because they've got operational constraints, they've got headspace problems, lack of management bandwidth, they're firefighting constantly. It suddenly struck me that if you've got that kind of environment, you're very difficult to get them to think about things like circular economy.
Yeah,
collaboration is at the will level, is there. But when you get into practical problems like that, you know, I think it's quite hard to break it down.
Fascinating. Yeah, it's one of those, it's definitely a stop, but also finding the right opportunity to push through. So, yeah, fascinating.
Well, let me put it another way. If you imagine the household level, if you had to recycle your own waste, if you had to smelt to melt your own glass down in your own back garden and then repurpose your own glass, would you do it? You know, if you had to physically take all your own recycling to the dump, every week, would you do it? You
know?
Yeah. That's to be easy for people. They just won't do it.
Yeah, absolutely. Fantastic. Right, final question for me, and then we're going to open up to everyone in the audience. So the theme that we've got this quarter is food. So I was wondering if you could bring back, you know, all the things that we've just talked about around tech, around the B2B and so on, and look at how could we use that to help transforming the entire food system somehow.
Sorry, I'm not 100% clear the question, so if we try again.
So how could we bring basically all the tech that everything that we've talked about, you know, like how can the tech enable to change the food system or the food level?
Well, the food system is huge. So do you mean the consumer side of it or the B2B side or?
B2B, because we're really on the B2B side. So on the B2B.
Yeah. Well, I guess there's probably two very distinctive parts of B2B. One is the kind of production, right? So farming. There's a lot in there we can talk about. And then from the farm, once it leaves the farm, it goes into the supply chain to the factories. There's quite a lot in there as well. I think the one of the things I'm really interested in, we're actually building a project for a factory right now, a food factory right now. We're looking at the supply chain literally right now. So this morning I was on calls with my team going through the supplier module of this system called Nimble. And one of the things we got really stuck on was provenance around supply chain. And how do you know I think tech can automate a lot of the systems behind this. So they kind of like centralization of registered information. You know, if you were to think about, it's astonishing how many questions they have to ask input, right? So this form, I can show you another time, but the form that we're building for this customer right now to capture their supplier's information, it is vast. I mean, we're talking, imagine a screen this size with 20 rows of questions. Imagine 25 to 30 pages like that. That's what the supplier has to fill in order to supply this company. It's like, what's your rodent policy? Your pest control policy? Is it separate for rodents, separate for insects? If so, who certifies it? When did they certify it? Can we show the documentation? It just goes on and on and on and on and on. It is literally the most process-driven industry you've ever seen. And as a result of that, there's a lot of work created just doing that kind of capture information and sticking it in systems and blah, 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 blah. So I think tech is really good at that. So humans are rubbish at taking large amounts of data and sorting it in our heads. We're rubbish at that. Computers are really good at that. People are really good at creative problems and computers are rubbish at that. So we should focus on allowing people to do what they're good at, which is creative leadership, thought leadership stuff, you know, and let dumb tasks get done by relatively dumb machines. So I think tech plays a really big role in getting data at a point that there's integrity around that data. So if you're thinking of using supplier X, you don't need to go and do your own due diligence. There's a centralized view of that person or that entity's abilities. All the documentation is in one place. It isn't today. I mean, we were having a right old laugh trying to get that data off third-party systems like BRC. The British Retail Consortium is the main food standards body. And you're like, you know, these people have your accreditation, right? So how do we tap in that? Where's the API to get that? And it's kind of like, what? An API, you have an API, we can go and get that data, interrogate it and bring it back. And you'll have to talk to Fred in computers because he knows about these things. And it's like that. And you're like, oh God, you guys are so far behind. So I think that getting that data, that big glut of data that sits in the industry into a central place, which would cut down a lot of the problems in the supply chain side, it would make things faster and easier to work. And I think that will help Circular, because if I know that you're a credible, trusted source, and that central due diligence is done, then I don't have to worry about it. Take an analogy with driving, for example, right? When you all get on the road, we trust that everyone else on the road has passed the driving test in the insured cars. You don't need to stop every driver and go, excuse me, can I see your driving license before I drive past you? I just want to make sure you don't crash it, make sure you've done your course. We trust that the system has policed these people and that they've got the driving license. Same in aviation. So, but yet in the food industry, it's like each supplier has to go and do their own provenance with each different, you know, so each producer has to go to each supplier to get the provenance done. So I think that's a big area that the tech community help in, is amalgamating that data, putting trust. Maybe it's a blockchain solution so that you get that kind of integrity, a distributed ledger technology. And I've done a lot of work in this space. I think DLT alone, which is what Bitcoin's built on, is a technology that takes trust at its heart and can empower systems like this on a very low cost basis without people going, well, I don't trust that system. Or, you know, secure. Yeah.
Fantastic. Thank you. I love all the metaphors that you're making as well, which makes it really like we can imagine it very easily. So thank you. Right. So last thing is, we always ask our guests if there is someone you would recommend for us to bring onto this conversation. You think about someone.
Someone you can actually get, or just anyone I think would be interesting to you.
Well, anyone you think would be interested, you know, for us to hear more about from a circular economy perspective.
Yeah, I think if you can get the guys from Shields on board, I'll see if I can get a hold of them for you. So they're the guys out in Essex or something, or one of our customers, N2S. They're based up in Bury St Edmunds, and they were our first customer. And that's why we did what we did in Souqbox, because we had, Takestock was our play. We were the market, but we built the tech as well. And then people came to us and said, look, you know, this could work in my industry. Could you build us a solution? So we set up Souqbox to be a tech company to build solutions for people. And that's got its own journey now. But N2S are one of the first companies in that space that really got this kind of circular thing, and that's what they do. So they rip out hardware, tech, telecoms, equipment. They rip it out. If they can repurpose it, they repurpose it. If they can't, they scrap it. There's a really interesting thing around the data side of it, and tech in particular. There's a really interesting angle. I suddenly discovered it's not really about the hardware. It's about the data that's on the hardware. And what the company wants is a legal bit of paper that says, categorically, your stuff will not appear on the internet. And that's what they want. And it's the certification of that and the due diligence and legal protection around this document that matters. The actual bit of hardware, they don't really care about that, to be honest. They just want it gone. Yeah. The fact that it gets recycled is nice, but they're really focused on none of the data on the hard drives. The hard drives get crushed. Each hard drive's archived in the system that we can then go interrogate. We can see for a fact that your laptop is definitely crushed and that hard drive is not a, you know, some Russian hacker.
I think, well, we're going to have tech actually for one of our reporters, so we're going to definitely take that. Thank you so much. Erica, I'll pass it on to you to see if we got any questions from the audience.
We had a couple of questions and thoughts. From my mind, when you were talking about organisations need to trust in procurement, I thought, well, that's not the government really. They don't mind that. But on the procurement kind of section area as well, there was a question or a suggestion also from Aditya, sorry if I pronounced it wrong, around, you know, how almost do you sell it into this kind of inertia, these business to business companies, but do you suggest doing small pilots with them so, you know, they see it and how it works, or how do you kind of get the procurement and these companies on board? I mean, COVID's helped, but...
It's a really tough one, and it's really individual. Good question, though, teacher. Thank you. What we've done in Souqbox, we've dialed back our rhetoric. So we've got a marketing guy that's working with Clark Edmund, and he and I have done a lot of work on this. And I said to him, it's a wee bit like we're talking about go to Mars here to customers who've not seen the Wright brothers plane flying at Kitty Hawk in 1903. So we need to take them back to 1903 and stand at Kitty Hawk and say, imagine this piece of machinery taking into the air. And not until you've seen that can we begin to talk about what comes next. And so I think this is part of the problem. So we've kind of really dialed back our rhetoric. We were talking about enabling circular economy marketplaces with one of our earlier strap lines. And we realized that that means nothing to people. It's standing in 1900 and talking about space travel, they're like, you sound like a fantasist, mate. So we've kind of gone, right, let's talk about what they understand today. So we brought our conversation right way back to basic 1980s e-commerce. So late 1980s, early 1990s e-commerce, that's where they're at. So we need to take them on a journey that starts where they're at. And then they're not all like this. There are some that are quite sophisticated, but the vast majority of our customers are still thinking about maybe one day in the future, the far distant future, doing online trading. Like it's something way out there. You know, my grandkids will probably do that. You know, it's kind of way, way out there. It's like, but this is now. And so we're kind of like, we're trying to make that so easy and so tech-like at Souqbox that we get them online. And on the basis, the hypothesis is that if you get them there and they start doing it, they will naturally then go at their own speeds, and that people will then come to you very quickly and go, okay, well, why can't other people sell on my marketplace and you go, or on my website? And you go, oh, that's good. They can. It's great. We call it a marketplace. You flick a switch and it just happens. And they go, great. And then they go, okay, now they're doing that. Now how can we use this for, you know, circular stuff, like secondhand stuff? How do we know that it's good? And go, great, that's the provenance module. Let's turn that on for you. But we think the journey has to be in baby steps at the moment for our customers. And that's why all of our marketing conversations spun back down to e-commerce. Because they understand that. That's here and now. It's make money. So sell more stuff tomorrow online in 20 minutes. How about that? And they're going to go, yeah, do that. And then we think that will happen, actually, that evolution towards a trusted marketplace that enables circularity.
There's also a suggestion for me, Aditya, around looking at kind of visualization techniques. And Sankey diagrams, correct me if I'm wrong, are the ones that you often see them over the waste and resource flows, almost showing the benefits and the amounts coming in and out, isn't it? So yeah, there's an area around, I suppose, visualization to support that as well. I'm just looking at the time. Does anyone else have any other thoughts, questions? I know Rob has picked up on that kind of element of trust. And I know in the past we looked at also thinking about councils and around procurement, or how do you shift that kind of area to thinking around circular procurement as well. So I think you've touched on that area quite strongly, and it'll be interesting to see, is that a market? Well, not, yeah, is that a market or a customer that you've looked at, the more kind of, I don't know, councils or government type organisations?
Well, the nearest to that would be the NHS. We ran a demonstrator module for the NHS during the start, well, last year during the COVID spike, phase one. I have a lot of friends in the medical world, and we started off having conversations around that about equipment, you know, the PPE shortages. It was very public at the time. And I was talking to one of my friends, a surgeon in Glasgow, and he was saying, there's boatloads of it. It's just all over the place, and no one knows where it is. And I'm like, that's interesting. So we threw up a demo market site, went to the NHS, a very senior level in the NHS. We're trying to get a ministerial level. And we said, look, you have this for free for as long as you want. Use our tech for free. And it'll enable you to move stuff at micro-local level, so within wards. And I gave an example. Like my mate recently told me about the fact that he's actually an orthopedic surgeon, but he was working, as all surgeons have, they moved into general medicine in case the COVID pandemic got and the Nightingale hospitals were going to be staffed with medics who were non- respiratory medics that were coming from every other field, plastics and orthopedics and whatever. So several of my friends who are exactly that, plastics and orthopedic surgeons, were coming in and retrained for a couple of weeks to get ready to do emergency care. And they were saying to me, that's incredible. He said one of them was working a ward and they had to order in some ventilation tube stuff, components, and they were paying like 50 times premium to get it that day because it was emergency. And then he was in the coffee shop downstairs on a break one time, and he was talking to a nurse who was from another ward, and he said, oh, we've got loads of them. And it's like, well, if only I'd known. And it's like, well, hang on, the systems aren't, and it's something got me thinking that the NHS is a kingdom of fiefdoms anyway, but it's not set up to cross-pollinate products across local macro levels. It just doesn't do it. It's inventory type system. It's built from top to bottom. And you get someone high up and go, how many plasters have we got? And how many of this have we got? And then get an answer from the ERP system. But what the individuals at that level can't do is say, I need to get this bit of kit. Is it anywhere else local to me? And can I activate a transaction that moves it from mine to theirs? That didn't exist. So we offered that kind of test, and sadly, what happened there, to be candid, was, and I wouldn't name them, but we got in front of a very, very senior person in the NHS, and he shut us down in less than 30 seconds. Mm. He went, no one's going to do that in the NHS. No, forget it. It's not happening. We're like, you've not even heard the pitch. So we spent ages getting that conversation, and he just shut us down in less than 30 seconds. His mind was so close to this. And it was, to be fair to him, it was the middle of the pandemic. He was getting publicly shot for the shortages of
people. Yeah, lots of things.
He wasn't in a good space to have that conversation with us, I don't think. But he just could not grasp the concept that maybe some of the answers are very local, hyper-local. And I think that's circular economy. It's a different kind of circular economy, but still moving stuff around and repurposing stuff rather than, you know, having this kind of chaotic 50 times premium. Was based on the fact that there was a demand, immediate demand for a product. And some companies said, well, I can get that to you, but I'll have to charter a jet or something. And, you know, it'll be this price. And you're like, oh, I need it. It's an emergency. Get it. And if they'd had an ability to interrogate the system, they might have found it. They could have walked around the corner and picked them up for free from a neighboring ward. They just didn't think they had them. So that's what I mean by circularity. I think there's many facets to it. It's not necessarily... you know, taking broken glass and turning it into new bottles or whatever it might be. It's often thought of, I think, as circularity as the product's reached the end of life. It's a case of breaking down its components and repurposing those components into other things, you know, clothing, whatever, building products, whatever it may be. I actually think that there's a lot in the circular economy around just the unknown supply. So your demand for a product somewhere and the supply somewhere where it's available, and the two parties don't know each other. There's no way of knowing that they exist. And I think that's, go back to the same with tech, connecting that dot, those dots, is the biggest opportunity in tech.
Yeah, I think that's a really, really good kind of clear kind of message to end on, is that kind of idea of so much of the circular economy is about connecting underused.
I think we're losing you, Erica.
We've lost you, yeah. Might be coming back hopefully. But yeah, anyway. Yeah, she's back. Yes. Erica? No. Okay. So I'm going to close it off. But yeah, I totally agree with her. It's like really the connecting the dot and bring it all together.
Yeah, frozen a bit.
Oh, you're back. Yes. Maybe? Yes. Okay, so I'm going to close it off anyway, so we're having a few troubles here, but it's really connecting the dots and looking at the different aspects, actually, of the circular economy, and I love what you were saying, it's really keeping the things in movement, ultimately, on all of that. So, Campbell, thank you so much for having been with us today. It was very interesting to look at this different angle, and thanks for everyone to join us. Have a lovely day.
Thank you. Bye. Thank you. Bye. Bye.